Our next presentation is an important one for the day because it brings us to think about security in an entire different way. Our next speaker poses the question, you know, are we thinking about security the wrong way? Traditionally, we've been thinking about security as a cost, you know, but given the world in which we live in today, you know, the perspective should be one of business enabler, one of actually a business driver, at least, and he will show us how we should be looking at it from that perspective. We're sort of a very important company in this space called International Data Corporations, IDC. He is the research director of the European Security Practice at the company for EMEA. So please give a warm welcome to Duncan Brown.
Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be back in Helsinki, although they didn't tell me it was going to be this cold. So I feel somewhat cheated. They said it would be spring, and it hasn't happened yet. Before I get stuck into the scripted presentation, I just wanted to call out what Erica was saying about attacking assumptions. In certain states in the US, they have a rule that you cannot put rubbish out on the street unless it's protected from bears. So there are companies who design bear-proof bins. It turns out that nobody told the bears that they were bear-proof, and so the bears just rip these things apart. And the point is, how can we as humans test that a bin, a garbage container, is bear-proof? You have to give it to the bear, right? And so there is this bear sanctuary on the edge of Yellowstone, which is a bear sanctuary, and they rent out the bears. It's like bear as a service, and they give the bins, or the prototype bins, to the bears. And if the bear can get in it, then they go back to the drawing board. Because we're not smart enough, or it turns out strong enough, to rip a bin apart, but you know, a 500 kilo bear, which is 10 feet tall, you know, just has a different set of assumptions that it's working from. For example, it doesn't understand what a lid is. It's there, it doesn't know what a lid is. It just goes in right through the side of the bin. And so it's a good example, I think, of how, you know, we need to think out of the box and get someone else who thinks differently from us to test our assumptions. So that's my bear story. I was introduced as giving an important presentation. I certainly think I have the hardest job today because we're talking about security investment and ROI, and I have had numerous conversations over, 30 years or so about proving the ROI of security, and there are skeptics and there are advocates and so on. So I just want to share with you some of the latest thinking in terms of how you can help your organizations build a business case and think about security holistically to hopefully try and persuade the naysayers and the skeptics that this is something worth paying attention to. The first thing I want to start with is, this is a genuine picture. A colleague of mine took it. And of course, there is a way of making your systems secure. You just unplug it. And I guess there are 2 points here. One is that even if you unplug the system, it's probably still not going to be effective. Because of what Erica was saying, there are mobile devices in our organization that essentially re-establish connectivity even when your hardwires are pulled out. The second point is that if you did this in any organization, if you actually acted on this and pulled out the cables, you would probably be fired. But as a company, business operation depends on connectivity. And if there's one big point I want to get across today, it's that you cannot do security at the expense of business. It's the other way around. Business has to happen first. And when I say business, I include public sector operations as well. they've got to happen. And we cannot let security get in the way. And sometimes we as security professionals are guilty of saying, well, security comes first and we want to protect the organization. And that's true. Sometimes we do have to protect the organization and sometimes from itself. But we can never get in the way of a business doing business. Otherwise, we've missed the point. So pulling the wires out might stop the cyber attack, but it might also stop business. And then, you know, are you actually any better off? I would argue that you're probably worse off. Where are we in security as an industry at the moment? I think there are three main drivers that we need to be constantly aware of. And I just want to kind of frame the discussion like this. So the first driver we talk about is the dynamic threat landscape. This is the stuff that we as security professionals are familiar, we're comfortable with, because it's about the stuff that Erica showed, the viruses and attacks and malware and all that technical stuff. And security can get really technical sometimes. We love it. We as professionals, we love the technology because it makes us feel important and it gives us some kudos and protects our jobs because we understand the technology and other people don't, and all sorts of other reasons. The thing to remember here, I think, is the key word up here is dynamic. The threat landscape is constantly changing. When I say constantly, roughly there are a million new pieces of malware that your organizations have never seen today. Yesterday, there was a different million that you'd never seen before, and tomorrow, there will be another million pieces of malware that you've never seen before. It's massively dynamic, and we cannot keep up using traditional approaches. Anyway, so that's one big challenge, yeah? And, you know, for 25 years or so, the industry has been faced with that. But as I say, security professionals feel comfortable with that because they understand it and it's technical. But there are two other big drivers that we need to get our heads around now as well. The second of those is digital transformation. We heard this morning what is the biggest challenge and change to critical national infrastructure, and this is digitization of the cyber world. This is digital transformation in another name. So this is the move to cloud and mobile and the Internet of Things and social technologies and big data and all that kind of stuff. The key point here is that this is a business-led initiative. So where we've got the dynamic threat landscape as a technology or security-related initiative, digital transformation is a business-led initiative. In other words, it happens whether you like it or not. And again, security sometimes is guilty of trying to stop it. So we, in the early days of cloud, were saying, oh, you can't move to the cloud because it's not secure. We don't have our arms around the organization. It's in someone else's building, not ours. How can it be secure? We didn't like mobility. So we said no to bring your own device. And what happened? People just brought their devices anyway and plugged them in and away they went. So we've tried to get our arms around the business terms of digital transformation, but we can't do it because business always finds a way to do business, and so it brings new challenges for security professionals. So that's the second challenge, and the third challenge is regulatory upheaval. We have some very interesting data protection rules, which I'm going to talk about later on in a little bit more detail. So not just GDPR, but we've got the Network and Information Security Services Directive and PSD2 and a whole bunch of other stuff coming. Well, that's just in Europe. And then we've got some other legislations that are coming around the world. So it's a constantly moving area. But what's happening is that it is now changing the consequence of getting a security decision wrong. And I'll talk about that in a little bit more detail. But anyway, we have these three big forces. What's really important to understand is that they're all interconnected. You can't do one these days without understanding the other. And the challenge for security professionals, whether protecting physical infrastructure or cyber infrastructure, as we heard earlier this morning, it's just infrastructure, right? It's just hybrid infrastructure. The challenge is to deliver security, but at the speed at which business requires it. We cannot do this and slow down business, because business will always choose business over security. So we need to do this at the speed of business, or preferably even help accelerate business, and we'll get to that at the end. Okay, so ROI. The cost benefit and the risk assessment of how much effort we put into security has always been there. So at one extreme, I've seen enough and I've talked to enough people like Mr. Cohen from the Israeli Security Service to know that any sufficiently motivated and resourced individual or body can essentially hack anything. What we need to do is to just make that harder and harder and harder for people to do. So the question is how much effort and resource and investment one puts in to security to make it hard enough for the vast majority of people who would want to attack us to go somewhere else. So in this picture of virtually identical houses, in fact, I think they probably are completely identical, apart from one feature, and I've circled it in red because it's quite hard to see, one of these houses has a burglar alarm. If you're a burglar, which house are you not going to attack? You're probably not going to attack the burglar alarm, even if it's just a biscuit box painted on the side of the wall. It might be a burglar alarm, we're not sure, but it shifts the risk assessment significantly in that it's too much of a risk. I'm going to try and burgle one of the other 10 houses in the street that, to all intents and purposes, are identical. Okay, so we are constantly making these risk assessments, but the adversaries are also making these risk assessments. So we're just trying to want to make them go somewhere else. And that might be moving from cybercrime into something else. Drug trafficking or people trafficking. I'm not advocating that these are good things. But in terms of protecting organizations, we might want to shift the balance, or protecting our organization so they might attack other organizations. I don't think we can ever eliminate attacks, but we can help reduce the likelihood that people attack us, and ultimately that's our responsibility. Okay. Which brings the question, what are we trying to protect? And the glib answer is whatever's important to you. It's in your brief to understand whatever your environment is, whether you are a private company or in the public sector, whether you have a very niche responsibility or very broad, what are the critical assets to the organization that you are responsible for? But there's some pretty big assets out there. So in the physical world, you got oil rigs and water supplies and electricity and traffic and more traffic and nuclear power stations and smart meters. And I mean, interestingly, increasingly, things like this, like data centers, both protecting them on the inside and on the outside. And again, you know, sometimes we are tempted to say, let's just unplug everything and that will keep it secure. But as I said earlier, that's really not an option these days. Back to what Erica was saying about SCADA systems not being plugged in, therefore they're secure. I think the opposite is true, that companies actively want to plug their SCADA systems and their industrial systems into the internet for business utility. So unplugging, I'm afraid, I don't think is an option. So given that it's not an option, the question that we need to be asking is security a cost worth paying? Or I suppose, how much security is worth paying? And that's the big question. So let's have a look at some of the ways in which security is traditionally looked at from a cost perspective. Okay, So this is how we normally see costs. We normally see them as physical things. That might be a physical lock like this, or it might be an instance of antivirus software on your PCs, or a firewall appliance in your data center, or something else. So we have that, and there's costs associated with that. And then we have the implementation, which is clearly not zero. And then the ongoing maintenance of that. And then probably we have something like depreciation, which if you're an accountant, you'll understand that that's important because the value of the stuff that we've done decreases over time. That's typically how costs are associated with that. And, that's kind of well understood, I think, and accepted. What's less well accepted is the flip side of that. What benefits are we getting out of security investment? I think there are three broad areas, and I just want to kind of drill down into these in a little bit more detail. So I think there's a broad category of improved productivity and efficiency. There's the reduced remediation costs. If things go wrong, when things go wrong, then there's a cost of putting them right. And then we get into the thorny issue of risk and understanding how much risk one wants to take on behalf of the organization. So let's look at these in a little bit more detail. So improved productivity and efficiency, this is interesting stuff. So obviously you would expect to get improved security from any investment. But I think also these days you should expect to get better visibility and control of your estate, particularly if it is connected to the internet. So clearly in the cyber world, it's almost by definition connected to the internet, but increasingly in this hybrid world, you're getting situations where locks are being, physical locks are also being connected to the internet to get that visibility control of what's happening out there in the field. You get a greater flexibility of key distribution, no pun intended. I mean, clearly this relates to both cyber keys and physical keys. Lots of people cling on to this idea of encryption as the savior, as the way of protecting our key assets, without really understanding that actually encryption is the easy part, key management is the really hard part, and very few organizations or organization types have a strong understanding of the costs and complexity of key management, or worse, the consequences of getting key management wrong. I mean, best case, you open all the doors open up access to all your information. Worst case is you actually corrupt all your information and lock up your business and essentially put your business out of business. That happened to a data center provider in the UK a couple of years ago. They lost the keys. They lost the keys for their customers, and so their customers lost their data. So not a particularly great situation to be in. And also, if you've got good operational control over access, you can get great granularity. So rather than just saying, admin access and everybody else access, we can actually say, no, this person has access to do these jobs at these times on this particular day. Tomorrow they have a different set of access to a different set of bits of information, or in the physical world to, medicine cabinets, for example. So I think there are big productivity and efficiency benefits by implementing good security. It's really easy to implement bad security and to lose all these benefits. So it has to be done with a bit of care and attention. And these, I think, are genuinely measurable benefits that we eke out of these attributes. I'll talk about reduced remediation costs. This is interesting. This is things like automatic lock resets in the physical world, or automatic password resets in a cyber world, where the cost of resetting access to information or to physical assets should be relatively easy, but it's often laboriously hard and difficult to do, requiring forms filled in and time lag and productivity loss and so on. And so the automated resetting of locks, physical or logical, is a really important cost saving for many organizations. Lower field service visits, if you're protecting physical assets, you don't want to be sending vans out to repair locks and windows and so on. Reduce theft and unauthorized access, both again in physical and cyber worlds. And importantly, and this is where we get to talk about data protection in just a second, auditability of what happened and who did what, when, why, and were they allowed to do this is increasingly important. And companies, I think, increasingly are going to be asked to report on this at company report level. In terms of, you know, having the forensics to explain to an auditor what happened or what didn't happen and what was the reason, what was the purpose for that. Interesting. So we get more benefits from that, and then we get into risk. Well, I think there's an obvious risk benefit, which is lower insurance. Insurance finds it really difficult to determine the risk of. Particularly cyber crime, but I think increasingly also attacks from activists or terrorists or state actors in the physical world as well. So they tend to overinflate or overestimate the impact, and therefore the premiums go up. So if you can demonstrate that you are trying hard to protect your infrastructure, then you can lower insurance costs. There's also a big focus these days on incident planning and contingency, which is expensive. But again, if you've got security processes and technologies in place, then you can help start predicting where these incidents are likely to happen and then manage them accordingly and have a management plan in place. I'm still surprised at how many companies do not have an incident management and incident response plan in place, and that is tested, and it's the testing sometimes that catches people out. And the third thing I wanted to talk about is reputation protection, because this is talked about a lot in industry in terms of particularly data breaches and so on. And there's a bit of skepticism, I think, that orientates around this, because, you know, companies like, I don't know, Sony and Target and so on did suffer substantial reputation damage at the time, but seem to have recovered. The key point there is that the reputation seems to have recovered and over 2 to 3 to 4 years. And the reason I've got the car and the guy walking is a reference to Mark Carney, who's the governor of the Bank of England, who said that reputation arrives on foot and leaves in a Ferrari. In other words, it takes years and years and years to acquire, but you lose it very, very quickly. And if you lose it, you start walking again. And that's certainly been the experience of TalkTalk in the UK and so on. They're still trying to rebuild their reputation after a hack that happened 18 months ago. And the chairman of TalkTalk has just stepped down. And the first thing that they said on hearing that news, the media said, Dido Harding, who presided over the UK's largest hack. You know, that's her defining moment in office. Not how much she grew the business or her charitable work. It was, you know, she presided over cyber hack. So her personal reputation has also been damaged by this. So I think there's measurable benefit from that. So these are the kind of main concepts and components, I think, of building a traditional business case for security. I said I'd mention GDPR, and I'm usually, when I'm on stage, usually talking for like an hour or so just on GDPR, because I think it is a potential game changer. But I just want to share one slide with you on this. So general data protection regulation is coming in next year, and It changes the game for the way in which organizations think about risk. So this is why we think that it's a game changer, but it's all about risk. And here's why the GDPR changes the assessment of risk. So first of all, lots of people are talking about the fines of up to 4% for a non-compliance, not just a breach, but a non-compliance. So that could be a whole range of things. So not just a breach. But I think that that's one of a number of big hefty sticks that the regulators now wield. So some of the other ones. So mandatory breach notifications. Actually, when you talk to board members about GDPR, you talk to CISOs, they're worried about fines. If you talk to board members, they're actually not so worried about fines, either because they think they won't get fined 4%, or even if they do, it's a one-hit financial cost that's bad, but it's not going to put us out of business. Reputational damage really matters to board levels because it directly affects share price, for example, or sense of confidence in consumers or citizens. So they really worry about mandatory breach notification. But there's more. So there is the prospect of class action lawsuits. So even if you're in the skeptics camp of we'll never get fined and reputation, don't really care about that, you'll care if you get sued by third parties. So these are people who are probably data subjects whose data you've lost, or possibly corralled by an activist group that takes offense to the fact that you didn't protect data sufficiently. And so even if you think that the regulators may not come after you, then activist groups might. And there's one other thing that not very many people talk about, but it's in there, and that is that you could effectively be banned from doing data processing altogether. I always have the article, if you're really interested and you go to the text of the GDPR, Article 58 is the one that you need to look at, because it's in there. So basically, if you are, I have to say, you've got to try really hard to get into this situation, right? But if you are in a situation where you can't essentially be trusted with personal data, the regulator can ban you from processing it. How bad can that be? Well, personal data includes employee data. So if you have a payroll, you can't pay your staff, then things are not going to look good at that point. You also can't process any customer data like orders. So you could very quickly find yourself out of business. So this is pretty serious stuff. And collectively, what it does is it shifts the assessment of data protection and the consequences for getting that wrong to levels that should change behavior. GDPR is all about changing behavior, because actually, this is the stuff, if you read GDPR, it's the stuff that we should be doing already, like protecting people's data. Why do we not do that? But we're clearly not very good at it. GDPR is about changing that behavior to making sure that we become much better at it than we traditionally have been. The best assessment of the ROI for, in fact, data protection, but broadly in security, was from a friend of mine, Robert Bond, who's a lawyer, who's one of the top data protection lawyers in the world, in fact. And he says, if you think compliance is expensive, try non-compliance. And you could use the word security in place. So if you think security is expensive, try non-security. In other words, we have to spend something, otherwise the consequences of not spending that could be catastrophic. It could put us out of business. And the question you should all be asking yourself is, what is that limit? What is the worst that could happen to us? And then how much are we prepared to defend our organization against that? I said that it was maybe another way of looking at security. I want to use an analogy that many of us in the security industry use, which is brakes. Why do we have brakes on a car? And you ask most people in the car, well, it's to slow you down, isn't it? Brakes are not on a car to slow you down these days. Brakes on a car are there to allow you to drive fast with less consequence, because at some point you can slow down. So if you think about brakes, they allow us to accelerate because we know we can stop. They can they protect our investment. So if we're heading towards a wall or a sharp corner, we can take evasive action. We can slow down and we can take that that bend. And they can also take us into new terrain, new markets. And so I think brakes on a car are a really good analogy for the way in which we need to think about security. In other words, investment in security allows us to accelerate our business. We can do things that perhaps we thought we couldn't do before. We can go into new terrains. We can go into markets that we might have thought were insecure, either from a physical point of view or from a geopolitical point of view. So I think that's a really good analogy. The other thing I wanted to say is that, back to the GDPR, there's a really interesting article, not very many people talk about this, but it's in there, is this idea of data protection by design and by default. And so, again, back to what Erica was saying about the Internet of Things, you know, is the cheapest components all cobbled together? Yeah, it is. And that has transpired the situation that we have today. But I guess my message to you individually is perhaps we need to think about security and take a longer view of security. I'll give you an example. 20 years ago, certainly in the UK, probably all over Europe, this kind of crime here was out of control. It was rife. People used to nick car radios all the time. There was a healthy black market for secondhand radios, ask no questions, tell you no lies, and this was out of control. And what did we do to stop this? Did we put more police on the streets? Did we, you know, put cameras on traffic lights and in car parks and garages? No, we designed the problem out. So we have this kind of thing. So you cannot steal it. And if you manage if you got your grizzly bear to rip this out of the car, then it wouldn't work. It's fundamentally built into the car. And so we've designed car radio theft out. It no longer registers on the crime statistics in the UK. It's a non-crime these days. We've designed it out. And there's some really interesting examples of how that is coming in a much broader context. So, for example, the CISO at Mercedes-Benz says that in future the best-selling car will be the most secure car. And I'd propose that we could take the word car out of there and insert your product or your service or whatever business you're in to the same effect. So this is my plug for F-Secure. I didn't know that Erica was going to be on the stage this morning. He didn't know I was going to say this. So this is F-Secure's yet to be launched, I think. So I'm probably stealing someone's thunder. Yet to be launched, secure Wi-Fi router that has security built in, because most Wi-Fi routers don't, and they're not protecting the business. And so F-Secure has kind of taken the bull by the horns and designed that into their product. So I wish it all success. But here's another example. So HP printers, they're actually marketing on the fact that this is the most secure printer on the market today. And so how secure does a printer need to be? Well, what do we do with printer? We print usually quite sensitive stuff like payroll and order forms and customer records and all that kind of stuff. CVs, again, you know, personal data. And lots of personal data breaches, which would incur a 4% fine, remember, come from printed material these days. So having a secure printer, and actually printers are one of the least secure devices that you will have in your organization. There's some interesting data points that I'll share with you offline if you're interested. So in summary, I think you can take a view on security as a competitive advantage for your organization to say we are going to be the most secure in our sector. I think once you start creating competitive advantage, then what happens is that other organizations, competing organizations, then need to catch up. And so then it becomes a virtuous cycle, but it needs someone to go first. So, you know, HP in this case has gone first in the printer world. And so the other manufacturers, Lexmark and Canon and Xerox and all these guys, are also charging into the secure printer market. Why? Well, because they're being competitively disadvantaged by not doing so. And so there's a virtuous circle going on, similarly with cars, similarly, I hope, with Wi-Fi routers, and so it goes on. At the end of the day, it all comes down to this. Are you a glass half empty person or a glass half full? And sometimes I think the world is divided into two. You either think that security is an opportunity to improve the world around you, to improve your organizations, and you're willing to take a bet that that it will improve the overall market, but certainly your operational effectiveness. Or you tend to see on the negative side is the cost, and we want to minimize the amount of security that we're going to invest just because that's what we've always done. Yeah. So you need to decide which you are. Are you a glass half empty or a glass half full? I would encourage you, of course, to be a glass half full person, to be optimistic about security and see the opportunities from investing in security. But ultimately, that is down to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for that excellent presentation. You know, I just looked up there are some great questions, and we do have a couple of minutes for them. One piece of data that I got my hands on during your speech as well is that the cost, just the cost of cybercrime, an estimate for this year, $450 billion for this year, but already in 2019, that's only 2 years off. Mm. Estimated cost of $2 trillion, four times. The investment rationale really becomes a lot, you know, clearer, you know, when you look at, you know, the kind of risks that we seem to be facing at an exponential level in the future. Mm. Thus, the question that we got for you from the audience is ROI. How do we calculate it? You know, we have a lot of mathematically gifted people in the audience. They want a formula. Can you give us one, please?
I mean, there are formulas out there. I mean, we can send you some if you're interested. I mean, I think sometimes, you know, you're back to what Robert Bond was saying. It's my favorite quote from him: is what is the cost of not doing it? The reason. I mean, first of all, we don't know how much the cost of cybercrime is. I mean, we just don't know. Yeah.
So
these are estimates. But the reason that it's growing at that rate, so four times in 2 years, which sounds about right. Mm. The reason is that they are better at it than we are. Mm. They are better at hacking our businesses than we are protecting it, and the differential is growing. So. We need to invest just to stay up. And in fact, what I ask all of the vendor companies that I talk to is, what are you doing to change the game? Are you just saying, malware, ransomware, for example. Ransomware emerges, and then we have a set of solutions that address malware. And then something else comes along, and we have a set of solutions that match that. What are we doing? If we're always just playing catch up, we'll never catch up. Yeah.
So how do we stay ahead of it?
How do we get ahead? And security by design, I think, is one of the ways that we need to get ahead. We need to think differently about, and that's where I think you get greatest benefit from. If you think differently and design security into your, it doesn't need to be technology, it can be your business process. If you design security into your process, into your staff training, into your induction, into your recruitment processes, then that's where you get the benefit. Yeah, and no algorithm is going to give you that calculation.
So the importance of design here, we liked your analogies with the radio and then giving some free marketing to F-Secure.
You're welcome.
You'll pay him later on, won't you, Erica? the sense is in a way an old radio redesign. You know, you're really designing the security into the product, making it more valuable. I think the most valuable aspect of the Volvo car from this part of the world has always been its security, and now this is becoming an attribute.
What would you say, safety, in fact?
Yeah, safety, security. Yeah.
But I mean, that's a good point. I mean, who gets into a car these days without safety belts or airbags, and certainly brakes? You wouldn't dream of getting into a car that didn't have these attributes. Why are we buying technology that has no security capability, and then we have to, would you buy a car and then, I need to buy brakes for that, I need to remember to buy seat belts for that? You wouldn't do it. Yeah, so we need to think differently about that.
And interestingly, somebody took your example of the houses in a row that all look together, and then one has seemingly like a security device or a burglar alarm system. And one of our people here says, well, isn't that a red flag? This house has something to protect. Let's attack that one. Isn't that thinking? They probably have something valuable inside. The others don't have anything valuable.
Okay, great question. So you're trying to catch me out now, aren't you? So the answer is that you must know your adversary. So I loved what Mr. Cohen was saying about the decentralized model of security, getting really, really close to your adversary so you can act in real time. So if you're, okay, it's a risk assessment. I reckon that the average criminal has probably got a crowbar and a bag of tools, something like that. And so he's going to take a risk assessment and say, on the balance of probability, that house is alarmed. These are not. I'm going to go in there. Your more sophisticated criminal with burglar alarm detection capability and a better understanding of what's in the house that was worth pilfering, that's a different adversary, and you need to have different techniques to address that. Yeah, so know your adversary is the message there.
Thank you so much, Duncan. Are you staying all day with us? Or
Until lunchtime.
Until lunchtime. So you're spending lunch with us.
Indeed.
Which is right now, actually.
Hurrah.
Yeah. Duncan, bon appétit. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much.